Everybody, welcome to the welcome back to the late block of BSG 3. We'll still be going fast, and we're gonna go fast with Final Fantasy 1. Still gonna be run by Cruel, our late night master, our Batman, I suppose. I'm looking at the screen and I love what's going on here, so I'm just gonna give you to him. And enjoy the run, because it's going to be good.
Okay, cool. So yeah, I guess I don't need another introduction since I just finished the other run. You keep an eye on chat for me, by the way, in case some questions arise or whatnot. So, first and foremost, these names. I've kind of promised some people in the Lufia community that I would do this. The Lufia, if any of the Lufia runners are in here today, they'll get the reference. I may be able to explain it later. Are we ready to start?
Yes, we are. At any point.
Okay. 3, 2, 1, go. So this is Final Fantasy 1 for the PlayStation Portable, and right off the bat we'll see probably the coolest glitch in the entire game, and it's also that what makes us very, very overpowered in this. So I bought a hammer there, a really weak piece of equipment, but what I can do with that hammer is I can dupe it into a different piece of equipment, specifically the knight's armor. So what I'll have here is, right now, I pretty much have the second most expensive piece of armor in the game on everybody, on their gloves. So we are already ridiculously overpowered, and we're like 30 seconds into the game. Basically, what happens there is, what I did is I went I loaded in my weapon slot on the same frame I switched character, and because of the memory cursor, I was on my gloves with the other character. So I loaded in the IDs from my weapon, but on the armor slots. So I get the ID from that piece of armor that corresponds with that weapon, which in this case went from the hammer to the knight's armor, and that just gives me ridiculously overpowered equipment. So yeah. At this point, encounters will be pretty much dealing one damage on me. They can't really do anything. We don't really have to bother with them. Now, our weapons are still kind of weak at this point. We still carry knives and staffs and whatnot, but we'll be upgrading that soon enough. So yeah, we'll see a lot of random encounters here. The random encounters at this point are basically where the big part of the RNG is at. Ideally, you'd get as few random encounters as possible, and ideally as few ambushes as possible, or just genuinely bad encounters, which there are a lot of. So that is pretty much what's going to be influencing our time here. Six encounters in already is not very lucky so far, nothing too bad. So I picked up the leather cap there, and what that does is I can dupe that similarly to the other one, but we are going to be duping that into the Judgment Staffs. Now, for those that are not aware of the Judgment Staff is the most powerful staff in the game. You generally get it from as a drop from Atomos in one of the bonus dungeons, Lifespring Grotto. You'd normally get this kind of weapon from one of the bonus bosses. It is still a staff, and staffs aren't generally too powerful, but, you know, it's still ridiculously overpowered for this point of the game. This is the first boss, Garland. Oh wow, it actually took me 4 hits. Generally that takes 3 hits, but 4 is okay. So yeah, that was the first boss of the game. Ideally, we'd finish this off at under 3 minutes, but because of the amount of encounters, we got a little unlucky there. So yeah, with that, we save the princess. We can bring the princess back to the king, and he's gonna build the bridge in our honor, so we can continue the adventure. So yeah, he's gonna thank us for, you know, saving the princess, and we know about the 4 crystals. We each carry a crystal, which means we're assigned as one of the Warriors of Light. and we're going to have to travel around the world, restore the crystals, and then save the world from chaos, or Garland, the guy that we just beat. We also get the loot there. Now, the loot isn't going to be doing too much, but it is going to be relevant near the end of the game. So yeah, in his honor, like I said, we're going to be restoring the bridge, and I want to pay special attention to the guy in the bottom left here. They're going to be working on the bridge here, and this guy is very good at bridge building. These guys are really quick, but look at that bottom left guy, waving his arm like that, not really doing anything, way slower than any of the other guards. I guess he's not really a particularly good speedrunner of building bridges, but you know, that's how it is. Not everybody can be as skilled, I guess. But yeah, they do very quickly fix the bridge for us so we can move on. They do ask what this has to do with a prophecy, and he just tells them, okay, well, the Warriors of Light are here in Cornelia. Why that bridge would still be relevant, it's completely unknown. I would rather have a ship, but whatever. So yeah, with that, we're gonna move on to the next town. Like I said, I would have rather had a ship. Oh wow, two encounters before the bridge. We are not getting the luck today. So this is a bit of an interesting cutscene. We're just gonna mash through. In the PSP version, you can mash to just cancel out a cutscene once it's completely loaded. This is the only version of Final Fantasy 1 where you can do that. You cannot do that in PSX or NES or GBA, only in the PSP version, which is a nice little time save in PSP, I guess. It's about a minute and a half long, that cutscene, so cutting it down to like 10 seconds is pretty big. And with that, we're going to be moving on to Provoca. Now, we can't really move on to a lot of places, but like I said, we would like to get the ship. Now, it just so happens there happen to be some pirates around Provoca who might be able to lend us their ship. The notorious encounter rate today is definitely continuing, though, so this is not what I like to see. Luckily, we're not getting a lot of bad encounters, but we are getting a lot more than I would enjoy. So yeah, with that, we're entering Provoca, and we're gonna go talk to these pirates. Like, we're just gonna ask them to give us their ship, but you know, they're pirates, they won't just do that. And with that, we're gonna show off the secondary effect of the Judgment Staff. So the Judgment Staff, I mean, we earlier mentioned it's the most powerful staff in the game. This is its secondary effect. In a Final Fantasy 1, you can use certain pieces of armor as an item, and you can just cast their move like that. And Judgment Staff is able to cast Flare, the most powerful black magic spell in the game. That being said, I mean, we just one-shot all of the pirates as if it's, you know, that was the second boss, by the way. That may not have looked like a boss fight, but that was the second boss. So with that, we're just gonna keep moving. They do give us their ship, no problem now. And we're gonna be moving on to the next town. The next town is gonna be Elfheim, or as it's called in the NES version, Elfland. Now, this is, you may have guessed it, the land of the elves. The story goes that a prince in the elven castle, the elven prince, he's put to sleep. He's under some sort of sleep curse. And we need to find a way to break him from that curse. We will get a great reward when we do. It turns out Astos, who once, it was a dark elf, he proclaimed himself king of the elves, the true king of the elves. He's got the mystic eye, through which he can wield a lot of power. Okay, this is a bit unfortunate. So yeah, and he's put the actual prince under a sleep curse just to keep him at bay so he can take control. Unfortunately for him, he's still missing the crown to do that, and the crown is hidden in Marsh Cave. So we're gonna actually go ahead and get the crown before we're going to move on to Astos. At this point in the game, like, there is actually a way to wake up the prince. We need to get the Jolt Tonic from Matoya. And Matoya, she's missing her eye, which is coincidentally the mystic eye that Astos now has. So basically what we'll be doing is we're going to be grabbing the crown from Marsh Cave. We're going to give that to Astos, fight Astos and get the Mystic Eye. We're going to give the Mystic Eye to Matoya. Matoya is going to give us the Jewel Tonic, which we can give to the Elven Prince, and we'll get the Mystic Key as our reward. And with that Mystic Key, we can pick up the Nitro Powder, for which we need in order to continue. Basically, this game is just one giant fetch quest. At least this early on, it definitely is. So yeah, Marsh Cave, not a particularly difficult dungeon. Most of it is just going through as quickly as possible. Not a lot. The encounter rate in this place is generally really low. Interestingly enough, it's actually surprisingly high, or surprisingly low compared to any other version. In PSX or GBA or NES, you'd be getting a ton of encounters here. So yeah, this is the Pisco Demon fight. In a glitchless run, these guys, you save right before this and you just bang on getting two of them. Because four is just, you can't beat that. But since our equipment is overpowered enough, we just do it like that. Generally on this level, they would usually one-shot me. And that gets me the crown. So now that we have the crown, we can move on to Astos, deliver the crown to him, and actually move on into the rest of the game. Now, we don't have a way of getting out of dungeons, at least not yet. There is actually a spell, Exit or Teleport, one of which we'll be getting later. We'll be getting Teleport later on. We can't have that at this point. There is another item we could get to warp out of dungeons very quickly, but it's only a 1 in 6 to get it. So it's not very consistent, and it takes a minute to get it every time. So every attempt takes a minute, and it's a 1 in 6 to save, like, a minute. So it's not really worth it to do that. There is a dungeon later on where it would be very helpful to have it, and it would save a minute if you got it first try. But, like I said, 1 in 6 is not particularly consistent. So just gonna have to beat through these encounters again. Not much I can do about the encounter rate. We'll just have to take it for what it is. So we're almost at Astos' keep, and once we get to Astos, we're gonna offer him the crown, so to speak, which is gonna, you know, he's gonna. We're going to be favorable for him, and he's going to transform into the true elven king, so to speak. Now, because he needed the crown to do that. It's the second magical artifact he needed. Now, this fight is actually really interesting. This used to be a two-turn fight every single time, but we've rerouted this fight quite a while ago, but to make it pretty consistently one turn. So Astos, we're going to Judgment Staff with both of the mages, and then do regular attacks with the other two characters. Now, the White Mage can do anywhere between 110 and 220 damage. On 220, I would just have one shot, or it would just have two shots with just two flares. But it's not particularly consistent, so we'll just use the Warrior and Thief to deal some chip damage. Now, he actually had a spell that could have killed off a character, because he has Death. Luckily, we did not actually get to see that move today. He was kind on us. So we get the Crystal Eye, and with that, we're going to be moving on. Now, this Crystal Eye that I just got, I need to deliver that to Matoya, and she's going to give us the Jewel Tonic in return. So let's do just that. Let's just go to Matoya, and I hope that we won't get too many encounters on the way. This area that we're in right now is most notorious for its wolf encounters, specifically this one. Wolves tend to outspeed you, and they are really difficult to run from generally, so it's actually lucky that we haven't seen a whole bunch of them yet, but they can just waste a lot of time over the course of a run. They are probably considered one of the worst encounters in the game. There's a couple encounters that can do that, but that is definitely on top of the list somewhere. So yeah, we're almost back to Elfland. But again, I mean, we don't have the Joltonic, so there's no point in talking to the Elven Prince yet. We're just immediately gonna head to Matoya. Now, we could have actually gone to Matoya earlier. We would have gotten the cutscene that she's lost her eye. But now that we already have the eye, we can just immediately deliver it to her, get the Joltonic, and be done with it. Under the bridge we built earlier, and on to Matoya. Getting lucky there and getting no sea encounters. Sea encounters can be annoying, depending on what they are. The most notorious being the Sahagin Big Eye. The pack of Sahagins with some big eyes. Those can be really painful, because Sahagins are really hard to run from, and big eyes can paralyze you as well. Okay, getting an ambush here is not a particularly big deal. We can just... especially since it's Ogre and Giga's Worm. So this is Matoya's cave. Now, keep an eye on those brooms that you see around here. It is pretty rare, but it does happen from time to time that a broom of like that can just get into the doorway and makes it completely impossible to pass. About 6 months ago, Osabe, who's a former French runner of this game, I don't think he actively runs it anymore, but he actually lost world record to the broom there being in the way. It can lose you up to like 40 seconds if you get unlucky. Luckily, we didn't get that issue, so we can just move on. So now that we have the Joltonic, we can move on, go to the Elven Prince, deliver that, then get the Mystic Key, and actually start progressing the game. Now, when we're going to the Elven Prince, I'm also going to pick up the next piece of equipment that we'll be using. Up to this point, we've been using our knight's armors for defense, which is incredibly effective. The problem is, it doesn't boost our agility, which means that running from enemies doesn't become any more easy. But there is another item, another weapon in there, the Mithril Hammer, and we can glitch that into thieves' armors, which each... okay, this is that annoying encounter I mentioned. But yeah, thieves' armlets grant 5 additional agility for every one that you have equipped. And I can equip 3 of them on each character, granting me a total of 15 additional agility per character. And that will make running away from enemies a lot more easy on me. So yeah, this is the Elven Castle, so let's go talk to the prince here and get the Mystic Key. So yeah, His Highness waking up. And as a reward, we get the Mystic Key. Now, the Mystic Key is what we need in order to get the Nitro Powder, which was in the starting town all along, but the king was just too greedy to give us the key to the door. With that key, though, we can unlock the door. First, though, we're gonna go get that Mithril Hammer, which is behind the castle here. So yeah, let's get that. And we're gonna be doing some more equipment glitching here. Pretty good. Now, before I'm actually going to head on, I'm gonna get one safety item here. I'm gonna buy myself a couple gold needles, and what that item does is it restores petrification, which is something that to this point we haven't been able to restore yet. That didn't matter because nothing could petrify me, but that's gonna change in this next dungeon. In the next dungeon, we can find cockatrices starting floor 3, and they can petrify me. You know, it would be kind of annoying if we'd lose a run to getting characters petrified like that. Be a huge waste of my time, so this is just a bit of a safety there. And with that, we're gonna go get the Nitro Powder. Like I said, it was in the starting castle all along. We could have grabbed it way earlier if the king wasn't greedy enough to not give us the key. So he restored, I mean, he was willing to restore the bridge for us, but for some reason he would not allow us access into this room here. Just let us grab this single chest. That's really all we want. We don't really care for the other chests. I could take the Mithril Knife here, and change that into black garbs, which could speed things up in Sunken Shrine, because there's a lot of unrunnables there. But it's kind of runner preference whether or not to pick that up. On average, it evens out pretty much. This is a little less consistent in terms of time, but best case scenario, it is faster. So we're gonna assume we won't get a lot of unrunnables and just go with it. So before we can actually move on, we're gonna have to make a quick stop in the Dwarven Cave here, Mount Duragar, and that's because they want to blow up a canal here. So what we need to do throughout this game is we need to actually gather the four crystals of light, the crystal of earth, fire, water, and air. And in order to even be able to get there, we need to move on to the next town. But the path is blocked because the two seas are not connected in any way. However, we can change that. These dwarves have been mining an opening for it. So let's make sure we actually can, and just collapse a whole part of the world here, just so that we can pass with our ship. I mean, they call this building a canal, but since this is in the middle of the ocean, I'm not really sure if that's a smart thing to do. Also, don't ask me why this entire mine wouldn't immediately flood. It doesn't. You know, there's probably a reason for that. Okay, we're gonna have the wall completely collapse here. Again, this cutscene is not skippable in any version, except for the PSP version. We can not skip a whole lot of it, but we can skip a few seconds of it. So yeah, there we go. So yeah, that destroys the land there, collapses it into the sea, and allows us passage with our ship. As you can see, there's no sign of any water here whatsoever, which is a little weird, but we'll take it. So we're gonna move out and we're gonna move on to the next town. Now in this next town, I wouldn't theoretically need to enter the town, but there is one piece of equipment I really wanna have. You know, we just upgraded our armor, but we still use staffs. That works very efficiently, but that efficiency is gonna run out once the bosses start getting harder, because staffs are, you know, it's still a staff, even if it's one of the most powerful ones. So instead, I'm gonna get a sword here. I'm gonna glitch that from a steel glove. And we're not just gonna get any sword. We're gonna get the literal most powerful weapon in the game by a very, very significant margin. To give you a bit of an idea as to how powerful this sword is, Excalibur has a base power of 45. Now, this sword has a base power of 125, which means it's almost three times as powerful as the next best sword. Not to mention, this sword also grants me a strength boost of 15. So, not only is it significantly more powerful than any other sword in the game, it also grants me that strength boost, so it's ridiculously overpowered here. Also, I made a bit of a mistake there in my formation change. So this is a sound glitch that tends to happen a lot in that area, actually. Very common. And we'll be heading right into the Cavern of Earth. So this is probably the dungeon we'll be spending, I think, other than the final dungeon, the most time in general, maybe just even the most as it is. We're gonna move on to, or we're gonna try to get to the Earth Crystal. The problem is, the way to the Earth Crystal is actually blocked off. There is a stone slab in the way, which we could get rid of, but in order to do that, we need the Earth Rod. Now, the Earth Rod isn't actually that far away from us right now, but the thing is, there's a giant blocking the way, and the giant, he's hungry. There is a way to convince him to move out of the way for us. That's actually not too hard, but we need a star ruby for that. Now, the star ruby just so happens to be on the third floor of this very dungeon, guarded by the vampire. So we're gonna have to move into the dungeon all the way to the third floor, defeat the vampire, get the star ruby, move all the way back out, get the Earth Rod, and then move all the way back in again. This is... yeah, this is pretty ridiculous. Luckily, our way here so far has been pretty good. Hopefully that'll hold on. So yeah, this is the vampire, which is the next boss of the game. And I guess I'll show you how difficult a boss this is. This guy can be really, difficult. Let's see if, how this will go. So yeah, that was the vampire. That was the entire boss fight. Our swords at this point are so incredibly overpowered that we just don't even have to bother. So we get the Star Ruby, and like I said, we're gonna have to head out again. Okay, so this is just a bit of backtracking. This is the last bit of backtracking we need to do, pretty much. There's a few points where I guess it's still kind of the same thing, but generally this is the last part where you actually actively have to backtrack, like, several floors. In that sense, this Marsh Cave, and I guess Cavern of Ice as well, are some of the worst dungeons in the game, and definitely some of the more RNG-heavy dungeons of the game. So yeah, we got lucky there. We didn't see cockatrices, and on floors 1 and 2, those can't show up in general. So we can just move on pretty safely here. Okay, gorgoyles can be a bit hard to run from. Hopefully they won't troll too. Okay, can we... Jeff, can you run? There we go. Good job, Jeff. Getting... okay, we're slowly starting to get a lot of bad encounters here, and this is starting to be a pain. We're still actually on really good pace, so it would be nice if these encounters would actually help me along a bit. Okay, so that should... yeah, we're out of Cavern of Earth, and we're gonna go get the Earth Rod here. So we need this in order to actually continue further into the dungeon. So let's go get that Earth Rod, shall we? So I guess while we're walking around getting the Earth Rod and actually moving back in, I can talk a little bit about how this run evolved over the past year. Because, you know, this run up to about, I'd say close to a year ago, August, September last year, the community of FF1 was pretty dead. The route had been set for like 2.5 years, it hadn't had any changes, and the record was pretty stable at a 137. You can probably tell by the estimate that that has definitely changed a bit. It was a very inconsistent route. The last boss fight was incredibly RNG heavy. It wasn't uncommon to die like two or three times on the final boss. And then the Final Fantasy Relay came around, and some people, you know, they were practicing for it, and people started to get into this game, and we kind of got into racing this game. I had just joined the community as well. They convinced me to, you know, just try it. It wasn't that difficult to run. And we started to do a lot of races, and usually in those races, it was like, okay, I'm behind now. I need to find a way to get back. So we started doing different things, and we just started skipping all kinds of stuff. Some of which worked, some of which ended up not working, but it did end up saving us a lot of time. The grinding went down from 8 minutes back, I think it was 8 minutes back then, 8 or 10 minutes back then, to the minute and a half that it is now. So you can see there that that's just a massive change there. And you know, all kinds of little route changes came to be, but it was still very inconsistent, which wasn't a big deal, but it was kind of annoying. It was really more of an annoyance than anything else. And then we started routing all bosses. We were pretty much done with any percent. It was fun, but, you know, we wanted to do something different. So we decided on an all bosses category. We looked into Full Bestiary, which was done for the NES version, but that would require doing the final, or the last bonus dungeon 8 times. So we're like, yeah, let's not do that, and let's just go for one of that. boss in one of that boss in particular. And at that time, we started looking into doing a Citadel of Trials, which meant actually doing class change again. And when timing that, it turned out that because we could skip a lot of healing because of it, and a lot of level grinding because of it, at the end of the day, not only did it make the route significantly more consistent, it actually ended up being about a minute and a half faster as well on average. So we had both a route change, we both had a time save, as well as making the final boss significantly more consistent. We actually got to the point where the final boss was pretty much 99% of the time you'd win. It's dropped a bit since, because the way we had it set up was pretty slow. But it's still a huge, you know, that was still a huge thing at the time. Gonna potion up again my white mage and that. Doing one more safety save. The safety saves is just in case I get an ambush by four cockatrices and they all happen to petrify me before I can do anything. And now we're gonna move on to the first super boss. So yeah, like I said, at the time the route was very consistent, which it wasn't ever before. And a lot of new people because of that started joining, or in part because of that. It was, you know, the community started to grow a lot more active, and a lot of people actually started to seriously look into this game. Now, at that time, the leaderboard was still not as big as it is these days. It wasn't until, I'd say, January? It was a bit earlier that we announced it, but I think it was January that we actually started. We held a Final Fantasy I tournament, just an any percent tournament. We had about 22 people join in, I believe, and that made the community grow immensely since. Ever since that point, times have been going down further and further. Also, if I might note, I might very well be on world record pace right now. This is a really insane lich time. If I don't die on Lich, this is world record pace. I think I'm about a minute and a half behind the current console world record, which is surprising. Don't want to jinx it yet, but anything sub 33 Lich is potential world record. And this is looking like a high 31, which is, I believe, actually ahead of the current world record by a significant margin. So yeah, this is one of the biggest run killers in the game, by the way. He has a move called Bizarra, which would pretty much one-shot my party. Oh wow, this pace is pretty insane. I'm looking at the timer now, and I have not been on this kind of pace in a very long time. So yeah, that was the first crystal down. We're still a long way away, and a lot can happen in that time. But, you know, it's a nice start to be able to say at this point, this is really good pace. The best lich that we've ever had was, I think a mid-30 somewhere. Like a 30-something. And this was 31, like a 31-25, I'd say. Don't want to jinx it, because anything can happen, because Cavern of Ice is coming up, and that's probably the most RNG-heavy dungeon in the game, but it's a good start. So yeah, with the Cavern of Earth out of the way, we can actually, once you get the Crystal of Earth, which we just obtained, the sages will actually grant you, they will grant you the canoe. So we need to go to the eight sages, I believe it's eight of them, or the circle of sages, or whatever they're called, and they're gonna get us the canoe. Now, what you're supposed to do is use that canoe to go to Mount Gulg and get the fire crystal. However, from this point on, we're kind of going to sequence break a little bit. After Cavern of Earth, pretty much whatever order you do it in is whatever you want. So we can opt to skip that dungeon, not go there by canoe, and first get the airship, and that saves about, I'd say, a minute, because it just gets a lot less random encounters. It's probably actually more, because it's actually a pretty big part you need to canoe. It's probably like a minute and a half to 2 minutes. It's never been timed, because we've never not used the airship for it. Yeah, so this forest can be a pretty big troll, because these Minotaur and troll combinations are pretty hard to run from. So hopefully it won't be trolling me too much, because I would like to keep up the good pace. Okay, so before anything else, before we're gonna get the canoe, I'm gonna buy a couple of ethers here. We need about 40 to definitely have enough to beat the game. And I'm also gonna buy the next piece of my equipment. We're gonna get a Mithril Axe. Rule, in case you're wondering, this is potential world record pace right now.
Awesome, dude!
That is one of my fastest glitches ever. So, and this guy, he's gonna give us the canoe. Now, that Mithril Axe I got, earlier I got the Thieves Armlets on my characters, but you know, we're starting to run into more powerful enemies, and it's starting to get more difficult to run away. The Black Garbs, instead of 5 agility, grant me 10 agility for each. Problem is, I cannot equip it on the warrior, so I'll have to bank on every one of my other characters to do the hard work for me. Okay, I'm gonna move it like that. That fixes my earlier mistake. It's only a very minor time loss on that. So with that, we can finally move on. So yeah, the Black Garbs should make running significantly more easy on me. Let's see how it works out. Yeah, these Sahagins, earlier they were a pain, but with all of these Black Garbs on, they shouldn't be too difficult. That being said, they're still getting attacks off, which is really annoying right now. I think in saying that this was world record pace, I may have just jinxed it, because we are not getting the luck right now. So we can just park the ship there, and we're gonna canoe to the Cavern of Ice. Now, like I said, I could go to Mount Gulg, get the Fire Crystal, but it really is not worth it for me to do that. I'd rather go get the airship first. Now, you may have also noticed, the HP on my warrior is awfully low, and the same goes for my thief. You might be wondering why I'm not healing, but that's actually intentional, because I'm going to be killing both of those characters off in the next dungeon on purpose, to speed up the level grinding by about a minute. The next time, by the way, we'll know what kind of pace we're on is going to be Rosetta Stone. If it's sub one, if I get the Rosetta Stone in under an hour, then we would still be on record pace. If not, then probably not. And we are losing some time at this point, so we'll see how it turns out. So I'm gonna save here, because this is not only the most RNG-heavy dungeon, it is also the deadliest dungeon, by a significant margin. Let me just try to explain shortly what can happen here. So there is a 1 in 64 encounter, it's called the White Dragons, which pretty much just mean GG right there, which is why we save. If that gets an Ice Storm off, it's just done, there's nothing I can do about it. There's these Cockatrices, which can still petrify me at this point. We can still get petrified for a while longer. So that could be a thing. There is Mind Flyers, who can kill upon hit, which is luckily not very common. That Dark Wizard, that's a 3 in 64, and if that's an ambush, they have Firaga and would completely wipe my party in one hit as well. There is these guys, Wraiths, Spectres, Ghouls, Ghasts, all kind of undead enemies that they can just troll in the fact that they can paralyze me, and they're kind of hard to run from as well. Okay, I am not getting a good Cavern of Ice so far. Actually, I'm going to staff here just to get rid of them, because I'm kind of worried that I may otherwise paralock. And what I mean to say with paralocking, what can happen in this run is, let's say all of your characters were to get paralyzed. That means you can't really do anything. The double judgment staff was more of a safety insurance there. It's not the fastest way to do it, but we are not getting lucky at all so far. I mean, the experience is kind of useful, but I don't think it really will actually end up skipping a fight anywhere. Also, there is this guy. This is a pretty rare encounter as well. This is, I believe, it's also a 1 in 64 of some sort. This is unrunnable, so I'd have to kill it. I'm getting all the rare encounters, though. That's really annoying. Gonna make a second safety save here. This next tile is a spike tile, so I will always get an encounter on it. So yeah, if that was an ambush, it's generally just worth it to just instantly reset over it. Luckily that was not an ambush, so we can just move on. Okay, nice preemptive there. So yeah, we're coming up on the mini boss of this dungeon. This dungeon doesn't so much have a boss, it more has a mini boss. It's not a forced, it is a forced fight to do it once, but we're not gonna do it just once. We're gonna beat him like 10 times. And that's just to get all of my experience grinding out of the way in one single fight. It's not a huge deal if any of my characters die right now, specifically the warrior or thief, because I'm gonna have to kill them off here anyway. So I'm gonna heal up. My black mage might actually die to Thundara because he's got very unlucky rolls on his HP. See, I'm just gonna defend here. I'm gonna bank for Thundara. Getting it first turn, that's good. That's good RNG. My black mage surviving, really, really good here. And that's Evil Eye. So that is the mini boss of this place. And once we beat him, we can pick up the Levy Stone. And we can, we could now just leave and get the airship, but I kind of need a couple levels. Now, we don't so much need the levels because we would need levels. It's not so much for the grinding purpose, it's for spells. Spells in this game require a specific level before you can learn them. And what I want to get is two level 5 spells, Hilara and Teleport. Teleport is going to instantly warp me out of dungeons, which, you know, you can probably imagine why that would be useful. It doesn't really teleport you out immediately. It teleports you back one floor, which in some cases is worthwhile to do. Hilara is the heal spell we're going to be using for the final boss. And we really only need it for the final boss, but it's kind of relevant to have it just for that. So we're just gonna make sure that we're at the right level. So I need level 19 in order to learn those spells. I'm only gonna be grinding level 18 and a half here. 17. Because we're gonna still have to do some forced fights. I will get level 19 off of that, no problem. So I'm gonna get level 18, which is... okay, not yet, interestingly enough. So I'm gonna have to do this fight two more times. That's one. So yeah, that's level 18. And this is gonna get me the necessary experience to guarantee level 19. You could skip that fight, but it doesn't guarantee that I would get the level up. And, you know, we would like to guarantee that. So yeah, now I can actually just heal to full, no problem. Gonna save up one last time for this dungeon, and we're gonna head out. Okay, generally an ambush on this fight means a reset, but since there's only 5 of them, it's worth it for me to not reset yet, and just hope I can run with the 3 remaining characters. Cool, that still worked out. Bloodbones are a fine encounter, because they're actually very easy to run from. Unlike some of the other things around here. These are the guys that can kill upon hit. They've got 2 moves, Mind Blast, which is really annoying because it can paralyze any character, and once they hit, they can instantly kill. I actually lost my very, very first run. It was an offline, you know, just learning run. Two mind flyers in this dungeon, and they've killed me twice since that day. This is a very unfortunate unrunnable here. Pesco demons, because they were a mini boss earlier, they are actually marked as an unrunnable encounter. I guess I haven't really mentioned that, but some of the encounters in this game are just completely unrunnable. We're just not able to run from them, no matter how hard we try. So we generally want as few as possible because, you know, we actually need to kill them off. So getting two of those here back to back is kind of annoying. But that's okay. But yeah, the game marks them as unrunnable, and no matter how much I would try, I will not be able to run away from them. There's only a few of them. That dungeon only had the Evil Eye boss that we just fought and the Pesco demons. But there are some dungeons coming up which will have a few more. This next dungeon, which is going to be the Citadel of Trials, which we're going to do in order to get the class upgrade, will actually have two more unrunnables, actually. One very common one, the Minotaur Zombie, we're pretty much guaranteed to see one or two of them. We'd be lucky if we wouldn't. And there is a 1 in 64 Dragon Zombie, which is also on us. We are going to have to fight it once because it's on one spike tile. It's the mini boss of that dungeon. A lot of mini bosses in this game. But we are going to have to fight that once, but we could also encounter it as a random encounter. It is very rare. It's 1 in 64, and I believe only on one floor. So I've only seen it twice, and I've in any of my runs, and I've seen it, I believe, once in somebody else's run. So that should say something about how uncommon that encounter is. So yeah, I've gotten a lot of pretty bad encounters on the way, so I think we might have lost world record pace, but maybe we can get back on it. Like I said, the Rosetta Stone is the next good benchmark for me to see what kind of pace I'm on. Just for comparison, which makes it kind of easy, the Rosetta Stone in the console world record is a 59:59, so exactly 1 second under that 1 hour mark. I think the actual world record has like a 59.5 or something. So yeah, we just got the airship. And the good thing about airship is, while we're in the air, we can't get encounters. Now, this next area, it's actually, since we need to park it very far away, it's generally actually slightly slower to take the airship over the regular ship. The thing is, it saves about a second to take the ship. But it's on average, but it saves about 10 seconds on world map movement to take the airship. So, you know, 1 second of time loss to 10 seconds of time save still equals a 9 second time save. There was some very extended testing done on that by Double Drop, the, I believe, current number 4 runner, who did like 50 plus. I think he even did more than 100, but I'm not sure. I know that he did at least 50 attempts of that and just took the average time, saw what it was like. So yeah, this is Citadel of Trials. This is where we need to prove, or no, we need to, in order to get the class upgrade, we need to prove ourselves to Bahamut. Now, in order to do that, we need to get the Rat's Tail in this place. An interesting note here is normally, in the NES version of this game, you actually have to show the guy the crown. And the crown is the trigger for being allowed to enter, but the crown is kind of a quest trigger earlier on anyway. So the developers figured, well, since it's forced, you know, we're just gonna have the player talk to that guy and it's all good. So yeah, getting the second Minotaur Zombie already, this is not lucky on Citadel yet. Granted though, the walk to Citadel was really, really good between landing the airship and Citadel. Generally, you get at least one bad encounter on the way, which I didn't. That's the third Minotaur Zombie, though, so I guess that kind of averages out, and it still becomes like an average-ish Citadel. The thing is, that experience is completely worthless to me. I don't really need any additional experience anymore for the entire remainder of the game. So these are nightmares. Okay, that was weird. So these are nightmares. They are actually a runnable encounter, but it's pretty hard to run from them, so we're not gonna bother right now. If it's a preemptive, I'll run away. If it's not, I won't. Later on in the waterfall cave, we will be seeing these things again, but by that time we've increased our agility again, and running at that point becomes pretty consistent. Okay, so there's really only two more chests we need to pick up. There's one coming up very shortly, which is the gauntlet. Now the gauntlet, we only really use that for one little thing in the game, and that's only near the end. But it's very quick to pick up, it's only four additional steps, and it does add a whole lot of safety to the final boss fight. And then there is the rat's tail right there. Now before we can actually head out, we need to do one more fight over here. We're gonna fight these dragon zombies. I could get lucky and get a mega elixir drop, but that's very, very rare. We did not get it. Getting the mega elixir drop doesn't save a lot of time. It saves a couple seconds, but there's not a lot of moments where it can be put to good use. That being said, we're gonna head back to our airship, and we're gonna do kind of an intermission here. We've been in dungeons, we've been in and out of dungeons all the time, so I guess it's time to do a bit of an intermission, just for the time being. You know, kind of catch up on all the shopping that we didn't do and all that stuff. I mean, we can do class change immediately as well, so we might as well go for that now. Getting into the airship. Getting really unlucky with an encounter there, and Sphinxes too. Sphinx ambush is really annoying to deal with. Sphinxes are generally pretty difficult to run from, and having it be an ambush is always annoying. See, I think we're not on world record pace anymore. That was a pretty bad mid game. We're still on a good pace though. This is definitely a run I can be happy with so far. So yeah, this is the class upgrade. We talked to Bahamut. We show him the rat's tail, and as our reward for proving our worth, he's gonna just give us this class upgrade. So now we're no longer the thief, warrior, white mage and black mage that we used to be. We just transformed into a white wizard, a black wizard, a knight, and a ninja. And most of that is, like, the stat upgrade is very, very useful, of course, because, you know, better stats means making it easier on myself in general. But as a wizard, I can learn teleport, which I can't as a mage, and that teleport spell is going to come in very, very handy in one of the upcoming dungeons. Speaking of which, let's actually just go ahead and buy that spell here. So that's Yalara. And that's teleport. Now before we go into the next dungeon and actually go grab the fire crystal, we're gonna go get haste, which is the last spell I'm gonna pick up here. Now, the order I do the next couple dungeons in is completely up to me, but there is an optimal way to do it, and surprisingly enough, the optimal way is kind of still the order the game expects you to do them. The choice between Sunken Shrine and Flying Fortress is pretty easy because we need to go into Flying, or into Sunken, in order to be able to even access Flying Fortress. But that doesn't go for Mount Gulk. Back when I started running this, Mount Gulk was actually done last. It was the fourth of the bonus, or fourth of the dungeons here. Interesting about this dungeon, by the way, you'll see me walk on a lot of lava tiles. That's to skip encounters, because as long as I walk on lava, I can't get into an encounter. So I can use that to pretty much get consistent no encounters in general. So yeah, just healing up my mage so I can heal Lara. Or is it just a quickly heal up? Because of course I am taking damage as I do that. Okay, so we're almost at the boss. Coming up now is Merilith. Merilith is the... Okay, got it, getting the one encounter still. One encounter in this dungeon is average. So I was hoping for a good Mount Gulk at least, but this is a pretty average Gulk. One to two encounters is average. So yeah, this is Merilith. She's the protector of the Fire Crystal and the second of the Elemental Fiends. This is also, in this run we won't be seeing that, but in all bosses, it's theoretically possible to one-shot this boss. If you get a crit from the ninja. She's got 1410 damage, and you can see how easily I can kill her off. Not a difficult fight by any means. And with that, we have two crystals done and two to go. We're definitely getting close to finishing up already. So, I mean, the first half of this game is a lot of tracking around, doing a lot of fetch questing and stuff. At this point, we're just gonna rush the crystal dungeons. We just finished off the first one, and we're gonna head towards the second one very shortly. Now, before I can actually enter that dungeon, I need to do one little thing. I need to be able to breathe underwater. The next dungeon is our water dungeon, because, you know, every good game has at least one water dungeon. And this game is no exception. But in order to go there, it would be useful to be able to breathe there. Otherwise, you know, we would die, and dying is not a good idea generally. So, we're gonna have to go here, and we're gonna make a stopping caravan over here. And we're gonna go there to get the bottled fairy. I'm also gonna get a couple Giant's Tonics. The Giant's Tonics are in case my max health is too low for the final boss, so I can increase it by 200 on turn 1. Just to add to the safety a bit. So yeah, we're entering Gaia, the Bottled Fairy escapes, and once we talk to him, as a reward for freeing her, she's gonna get us the Oxyale, and Oxyale is what we need to breathe on their water. So yeah, there we go. That's the Oxyale. So I've got about 3 minutes left to get the Rosetta Stone. That might... If I get like the god-like Rosetta or god-like Sunken, this might still be on pace. We definitely lost a bit of time on record, but it might not be completely impossible right now. What am I doing? See, I'm teleporting out. Teleporting out is about as fast as walking out, but it sets my cursor, and since I need to set the cursor at some point anyway, that's just a really convenient spot to do that. Okay, so we're gonna need really, really good luck from this point on, but it might not be impossible to get the record from here. Granted, my PB, which is the console, well, it's at least a console record, is really good in the late game, but has a really, really bad early game. So this is on rack, and from here we can move into the next dungeon, the Sunken Shrine. Oh, come on, dude. Get out of my way. Wow, that's actually pretty rare. That guy doesn't stand in your way that often. It happens, but it's generally considered pretty unlucky because of how rare it is. So yeah, this is another one of those cutscenes, only skippable in the PSP version. You actually skip a good part of it. The Rosetta Stone, which is my benchmark for 1 hour, is on the it's two floors from here. The last of those floors not being able to spawn encounters, the other two will. So this dungeon, the Sunken Shrine, is notorious for its unrunnable encounters. There are a ridiculous amount of unrunnable things. This is not one of them. There is ghosts. There is the combination of Sahagin princes and chiefs. There is water elementals, which are actually runnable if tied with a water naga. In every other condition, they're not. You know, so there's a lot of ways you can lose time just to having dumb encounters, and I think, yeah, this is not the pace. Unless I get, like, no encounters from this point on. So yeah, this is not. We lost world record pace in the mid-game. We're not that far off. We're definitely on a really good pace for a marathon. But I don't think this will be able to record. Especially if I get enemies like this thrown at me right now. This is the first unrunnable encounter. Ideally, we want to see as few of these as possible. So yeah, there is the 1 hour mark. So unfortunately, we're not that far off of that console record, actually. I'm about plus 25 seconds on the console world record. But like I said, console record has a really, really good late game, so it's unlikely I'll save it after this. Yeah, we're 29 seconds behind. So yeah, this is the first use of teleport. We would have to walk back all the way and just backtrack to this floor, but through teleport we don't need to do that anymore, and we can just warp there. Saves about a minute and a half to 2 minutes. Okay, thank you, game. I'm really gonna need some decent luck if I want to stick close to the record, and getting encounters every 4 steps is not particularly helpful. Nor is this. So this is the Sahagin Prince in Chief, which is the next unrunnable. This unrunnable is actually not, you're not able to one-shot it unless you use one of the mages for that staff. If I were to use my warrior or thief, I will not one-shot the blue ones. Which is why I had the mages set up with the staff to begin with, just in case I got that encounter. Now, there is one item that I'm going to be picking up still before we move on to the boss. And we're also going to finish up our equipment for the remainder of the game, with the exception of one item. There is one... We'll keep the shield slot empty. I'm going to fill that up during... or at the end of the waterfall cave, which is the next dungeon. Every other bit of equipment I'm going to finish up here. And I guess the staff for my white mage for the final fight, but that's really only for the final boss fight. So yeah, this is the light axe, and that transforms into the survival vest, which is the, I believe, second best piece of armor in the game. Grants an agility boost of 15, which on its own makes it really, really useful for me. I'm gonna do Lordly Robes on my White Mage, and the reason we do Lordly Robes on the White Mage is to increase her intelligence. Basically, by equipping the Lordly Robes on her, I boost her her magic, her intelligence by 20, and I got 2, so I boosted it by 40. And that's actually going to make that, combined with a staff that I'm still going to equip on her near the end, is going to get her the kind of agility that, or the kind of intelligence that makes Hilara heal for the same amount Hilaga normally would, which saves about 14 levels of grinding. In a glitchless run, you actually have to go for Hilaga or you won't have the kind of healing, but because of this item, we can skip all of that grinding. And with that, we're getting pretty close to the Kraken. So the next boss is the Kraken, which, you know, you may remember from, like, well, it gets referenced in a ton of things. He's the protector of the Water Crystal, and let's see if we can beat him. This is probably one of the more easy Archfiends in his first... one of the more easy Elemental Fiends in his first form, and one of the more difficult ones in his second form. First form, he's generally not too dangerous, but second form, he's really, really scary in a glitchless run. Not in Glitch. In Glitch, he's easy, because everything in Glitch is easy except for the final boss. So yeah, that was the Kraken. That's 3 down, 1 to go. So yeah, that was a very average Sunken. Definitely not the kind of Sunken I need for a record, but definitely good enough for the marathon setting. So, the cutscenes we get to see in between here, by the way, these are the unlocking of the bonus dungeons. This game has got 5 bonus dungeons. There's 4... One for each of the elemental dungeons, so that's Lifespring Grotto, and they have the bosses of other Final Fantasy games in it. So, for example, we'd have the FF5 bosses are in that one. In one of the later, or the next one that we'll be unlocking, which is the last one, we'll have FF6 bosses, you know, all kinds of stuff like that. But... you know, it's just too slow to actually go there. In the old bosses run, we would. We would also grind a couple additional levels, because for some of those dungeons, you do kind of need those levels. For this particular run, that's not too relevant. So before we can head to the next dungeon, we need to make a couple quick stops. First off, I'm gonna have to get the waterfall, or the warp cube, which is in this dungeon. It's on this floor. We just need to go through this dungeon quickly. Now, this dungeon is notorious for its encounter rate. It's got one of the highest encounter rates in the game. And there can be some annoying stuff like nightmares. Now, before we got teleport, once you would be done with this, you'd actually have to walk all the way back out, which wastes a ton of time. Luckily, now that we have teleport, we don't need to bother with that, and we can warp out as soon as we have the warp cube. Now, along with the warp cube, I'm going to pick up one other thing, the ribbon, which is... it's a minor little item. The ribbon is an item that, when equipped, it's a helmet. And when equipped, it blocks all elemental damage for 75%, or no, 50%. So 50% damage resistance to all elemental spells, as well as protecting me from every single status effect in the game. The only thing at that point that could still get a status effect on me would be the Mind Flyers, because for some reason that's not labeled as elemental. Can I run, please, game? Thank you. So yeah, imagine, you can see how incredibly annoying nightmares already are, let alone if I have, like, 15 lower agility than I do now. You can probably imagine why I killed them in Citadel earlier. See, a bit of a spike tile here. The ribbon. Robot moving towards me there is favorable. Saves me walking around and saves me an encounter check as well. Best text box in the game. And then, okay, so this is a bit of a weird equip menu. Okay, wow, that was pretty sloppy. There we go. So yeah, what I did there is I got myself a ribbon, but that means I only have one ribbon. There are actually four in the game, although one of them is in the bonus dungeons, and one of them is really far out of the way. One of them would actually be pretty close by as well, but it'd still be slower. So, but I would like four, because I'd like to get that, all of those, you know, all of those perks on every single character. So what I did is I glitched it into a weapon, in this case the Gigant Axe, and from that weapon I glitched it back into the ribbon and I put it on shield slot. Now the reason I haven't equipped anything on shield slot to this point is because most of the things, when equipped on the shield slot, they would heartlock the game. And when trying that yesterday, I actually managed to make the game heart reset my console. Because apparently... Yeah. So, let's not do that. Instead, we just had to keep it empty. But there is a few items that don't heartlock when equipped on the shield, and that just happens to be one of them. The reason for that is that whenever you're defending with one of those items, the game tries to call up a shield animation because, you know, it's that you've got something in your shield. The problem is, most pieces of armor, if I equip it there, it's not a shield, so it can't call up a shield animation, and it can't call up any other animation, so it just hard locks because it doesn't know what to do. The ribbon, fortunately for us, is tied to a different animation, specifically the animation of my sword. So whenever I would block now, I would get to see the animation of my sword, and thus it doesn't soft lock, or hard lock. Okay, so this is Lufenia. This is where we get to learn the language of, We just learned Lufenian, which is what they speak here. And now that we know Lufenian, we can go here to pick up the chime, which we need in order to get the Mirage Tower. This place is also notorious for its NPC movement. NPCs tend to just block you just about everywhere. So yeah, that's the chime. And with all that, we can finally move on to the final dungeon. Or not final dungeon, but the before last dungeon. At this point, there's three dungeons left, technically. Two of which are tied to each other, which is what we're going to do now. We're going to go to Mirage Tower. And from the top of Mirage Tower, I'm going to instantly warp into Flying Fortress. Which is what that warp cube was for. And after we finish Flying Fortress, we head on into the final dungeon. Okay, getting pretty decent Lufenia walks. The walk too was pretty good if it wasn't for that unrunnable near the very end there, but still a really decent walk. The way back to the airship is also not terrible. I haven't gotten any unrunnables, so yay for me, I guess. So we're gonna move right into the desert and onto Mirage Tower. Yeah, Mirage Tower, another dungeon with a very high encounter rate. Most things luckily aren't too troublesome, but there are just a lot of encounters in general. Oh, wow. That's actually a 1 in 64 encounter. The blue dragon there is 1 in 60, is the only unrunnable in this dungeon, and it's a 1 in 64. It's the super rare encounter on this in this dungeon. So pretty unlucky we got that. Then again, the additional experience might actually start helping me. Because my black mage is ridiculously low on HP. For the final boss, you generally would like the black mage and the thief to both be above, ideally, 250. For the black mage, you can go as low as 235 and still be able to reasonably be able to beat him. But he's not even close to that at 152. That is what the giant sonics are for. But getting a bit of extra health means I'm more likely to actually get through the first turn. So yeah, here we're gonna fight the blue dragon again. This time it's a spike tile. And with that, we're warping into the before last dungeon of the game. The Flying Fortress. So Evil Eye, we saw him before. He's coming to take revenge on all of his friends we killed. Unfortunately, we're still as powerful, and now we're of a higher level and have twice as many characters. So we don't really care for Evil Eye. There's another one. Oh god. These things are being pretty resisting so far. They are not ready to give in. Still, it's only a short dungeon here. Now, on the last floor of this dungeon, there is also a really interesting 1 in 64 encounter. It's called the War Mech. In the NES version, or actually in any version except for the PSP version, it's a unique 1 in 64, meaning you can only encounter it as a 1 in 64 on that specific floor and nowhere else in the game. In PSP, though, it's in the fifth of the bonus dungeons, the Labyrinth of Time. So I'm going to save here, and I'm doing that way before Tiamat, and that's just because of that 1 in 64. It would be really nice to get it, because it's actually a lot of experience. It gives the most experience of any encounter in the game. It gives 32,000 experience in gold, which, for comparison, Evil Eye gave, like, I believe, 2,500 or 3,000 or something. So it's a ridiculous amount, but he's actually kind of deadly as well. Air elementals, only unrunnable, or only runnable elemental in the game. Except for dark elementals in the bonus dungeons. And this is Tiamat. Now, to give a bit of an idea as in terms of time, on an average final dungeon is about 12 minutes. Record is a 127.01. So we are not going to be beating that. We lost too much time in the mid-game. Late game has been pretty decent, but we just lost too much time in Cavern of Ice and Citadel and whatnot. So I need to get a really, really godlike final dungeon, and even then I'd highly doubt it. Because generally we count about 10 minutes after Death Eye, which is the first boss in the bonus dungeon, or in the final dungeon. Ooh.
Yep.
I'm about to head into the final dungeon, so if you still want to call Jasper, now would be a good time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've tried just a few minutes ago.
Cool. Yeah, probably. So, that being done, we just unlocked Whisperwind Cove, which has the Final Fantasy VI bosses in it, and we're heading in towards the final dungeon of the game. So, you might recognize this dungeon. This was the very first dungeon of the game. There's this weird shrouded guy, or this weird cloaked guy that we see. He actually shows us the location of the fifth and final bonus dungeon. This bonus dungeon is only in the PSP version. It's the Labyrinth of Time, and it's the most difficult dungeon in the game. It's what most all bosses runners consider to be the reason they stop running, or the reason they don't run it as much. I actually personally really enjoy the dungeon. I think it's a really fun dungeon. I average at about 32 minutes for that, although to be fair, most take at least a good 10 minutes more. See, I'm gonna make one final safety save here, and then we're just heading in. See, I've got 8 minutes for the final dungeon, and that's just not possible. We are, though, on a really, really solid pace, and if I can get sub 130 in a marathon, that would be pretty insane. I've only gotten sub 130 once in my current PB run, which was a race, but still, which is still considered console world record to date. Need to get decent RNG, though. So yeah, there's some pretty deadly encounters on this floor, mainly that white dragon. They've got Ice Storm, and Ice Storm just deals a lot of damage. It is one of the few dragons you can actually run away from, so we'll try to do that as much as we can. Now, this floor is most notorious for the green dragon, which is an unrunnable, very common here. Speak of the devil. And it can deal a lot of damage, and it can really slow you down here. A lot of these early floors here have at least one or two notorious 1 in 64 encounters, or one or two notorious unrunnable encounters, and you just don't want to see them. Judgment staffs would not kill unless from the White Mage, and since the White Mage is bound to act last, it's not worth it to do that. Because they would get like three or four poison gases off if I get unlucky. Okay, this might actually not even be sub 130 pace anymore. So yeah, at about 10 minutes from this, and that's about what we get on pretty average luck. That was Death Eye. So we're gonna be using the loot here, which we got about 5 minutes into the game. In a casual playthrough of, for example, PSX or NES, you actually have to use that from the menu. So in a PSX or NES version, you usually have completely forgotten it at this point. So you just have to, and you can just get stuck on what you even have to do there. There is, I believe, an NPC in the starting town that mentions what the loot is for, but since you don't get to use it between 5 minutes into the game and now, most will have forgotten at that point. Still got this one. This is the Ice Gigas Winter Wolf, which is probably one of the most annoying unrunnables. It's only a guaranteed one-shot if done by the White Mage. But since they're usually with more than four, it's, you know, Judgment Staffing does end up being faster. Really annoying encounter, definitely one of the more hated hated unrunnables there. Definitely not a favorite of mine. White dragons. White dragons, as scary as they are, they're kind of the good encounter and the bad encounter at the same time. They're runnable, which makes them a good encounter because you can run away and running away is quick, but then they're also scary in the sense that they can actually kill you. So it's kind of like some people don't mind it so much. I don't personally mind them much, but there are runners that have lost world record pace runs to those kind of dragons. I believe the best of what I've heard of is somebody on a 125 pace, which is more than a full minute under the record, and he just lost it to white dragons there. Earth Elementals only unrunnable on this floor. So this next boss is actually... So as we're going through this dungeon, we'll have to do a couple boss fights again. This is where we do the refights with all of the elemental fiends. Now this first guy, he's not particularly scary by any means, but he can seem very scary. As long as I'm full health going into the fight, I cannot die. So I can just go for it. He has one really scary move, Flare, which will guarantee which will definitely one-shot both of my mages. Both my ninja and my black mage, sorry. My white mage and warrior will always live at full health at least. He didn't cast it though, which saves me healing up. Okay, the Merolith floor. This is kind of a gauntlet that we have to do here with all of the refights. Every floor has a boss. And on the fifth of those bosses is the final boss of the game. Oh, wow. This is a very rare fire elemental encounter. I've only seen it twice before. Only once in a run of my own. This is the only unrunnable on this floor, and it's very, very rare. I believe it's 1 in 64. Getting pretty bad encounter luck here. I have actually done this floor encounterless before. That can happen. Okay, so this is the second of the five bosses. We're just gonna refight Merolith. Merolith is not as scary as Lich is. Both in pretty much every form. Lich is the scariest of the four, then Tiamat, and then Kraken and Merolith are just there. They don't really matter. Rul, should be about 5 more minutes, so you may want to try now. So this is the Kraken floor, and the Kraken floor is most known for the water elemental encounter here. Water elementals are super, super common here. Well, that's never happened before. Yay! I have never seen that floor encounterless. That would be like a 15-second gold for me on that split. That's an insane Kraken floor. I have honestly not ever seen somebody get that encounterless. So yeah, this is the first fight where we're going to be using haste. And we're going to use that haste to guarantee a two-turn fight. This, if I don't, it's a range. It can be two-turn, it can be three. But by using the haste there, I guarantee that it'll be a two-turn fight. And with that, we're about to head into the final boss fight, actually. The Kraken floor, I saved like a minute there just because it was encounterless. And like I said, that's never happened before. At least not to my knowing. So yeah, unfortunately our HP is pretty bad. World record just finished, by the way. So we are not far off, actually. For a marathon, this is a really, really solid pace. Okay, just gonna save up here. I'm gonna have to do one last bit of equipment. We're gonna get out of the golden staff, and that golden staff is gonna again increase my intelligence by 20. And with that, we're gonna start this final fight. So yeah, console record is a 128.23, and this fight takes about a minute and a half on good RNG, so you can see that, like, this is definitely not record. But, with good luck, I might be able to pull off a 130, which I've only managed to do once before. So I'd be pretty hyped if I could. So yeah, the Giant's Donic there to increase his health there. If he lives the first turn, which I think he should on Blaze. I'm pretty sure he lives. He doesn't. Oh wow, by 2 damage. That's really unfortunate. Because that means I actually have to Phoenix down here. Because I am going to try to revive him, because I don't have any hastes off. Haste is a move that pretty much just doubles my attack. I need a physical move. I am in a really bad position here. This is really unfortunate. We're losing a lot of time on this boss. I need him to do a physical move. Okay, that's good. That's what we needed. Because now I actually have a chance to revive my Black Mage and I can continue the fight the way I should. Bit of a time loss there, but so be it. So yeah, start getting ready on time. Time is as soon as the boss flashes white on the final hit. Okay, Tsunami. Tsunami is a pretty painful move. Oh, okay, that is really unfortunate. I have the most important haste off, but that is still really, really painful. I'm gonna try to do it without reviving him, I think. I don't know if it would be worth it, but if my thief dies on this, I'm gonna have to reset the fight. This is like the worst possible RNG on this fight, pretty much. My thief can die here. Yeah, that is really unfortunate. But like I said, that's the risk you take in that fight. 120 or one or actually yeah, we should be good. So getting really, really unlucky. I hope I can actually manage to get through this because I didn't equip the golden staff. I need to equip the golden staff. Due to the way my health is, I pretty much need that in order to win. That was a minor mistake there. That 20 extra intelligence just boosts my healing to the point that I actually can make use of it. Still very unlucky that I couldn't get this fight the first turn. This fight is about 90% to win. So it's pretty consistent at this point. But I got very unlucky with my Black Mage. And my ninja should be high enough, but he's kind of on the low end of it. Getting the Giant's Tonic off again. Okay, Blazaga I should live because I actually get reduction in damage because of the ribbon. So Blazaga is fine. Okay, this fight is already looking a whole lot better than it was earlier. That's a pretty painful hit, but it doesn't matter too much. Physical hits are generally okay. Unless they crit my White Mage or something weird like that. Okay, Blaze shouldn't do a whole lot. This should be... Yeah, we should be getting... Or we should be finishing up very shortly. Bit of an unfortunate miss there, but I don't think it's worth it for me to haste my thief or my Black Mage again. Okay, get ready on time. I think it's next turn, but I might be a turn off. This guy's got 20,000 health, by the way, so it's quite a bit of health to deplete. Okay, that was not an option. I thought that would probably do it, but... Oh, that's actually bad. Was not expecting him to one-shot my ninja there. Time. Sorry. So yeah, that was Final Fantasy 1. Got a very unlucky final boss, but pretty good run overall. World record pace for the first 30 minutes, and then we kind of lost it in mid and late game. But still, 133 is definitely not bad for a marathon. That's about 5 minutes off of the console record, so not bad at all. So we get a bit of an outro here. You know, it tells a bit about how the piece has returned to the world. It also stays white for a little while. But yeah, there we go. And it tells us that the time loop, we basically traveled 2,000 years back in time. They don't say a whole lot about that, but we did. We finished that time loop. And the war is now over and peace has prevailed once more. So, yay for that. And I think we're gonna have to try to get us a backup run of sorts, because we have quite a bit of time left until the next run, if I'm not mistaken. So we're gonna be seeing what we can do on that, and I guess we'll be right back.